Well, my dear brothers and sisters, we are addressing those who will be consecrated today for the first time and those who have already been consecrated and who will also renew their consecration today. And the feast is that of the Holy Cross. When we talk about what of the most of the things that we missed in the Catholic Church since the Reform, one of them is the Holy Cross. Because our Lord said in this message, Barnabas said, he saw a heap of rejected crosses. A heap of rejected crosses. So, because we find it difficult to comprehend the importance of the cross in the Christian religion. It's something that you can't just, when you talk about salvation, salvation goes with the cross. When you talk about our Lord Jesus Christ, he's always on the cross. In fact, there was a time somebody told me that Pastor Ikoke had some Muslim people who worked for him. One of them was a driver. So he said, every day, everywhere they go, he will see this cross. Every church, cross, everywhere. So one day, the other one, he said, now when this man will come down from this thing now? So he said, he had a voice in his ear that said, when it is consummated. He was asking, when will our Lord come down from the cross? Those who crucified him, they didn't understand that they are making a permanent structure. They are making a permanent image that will last for centuries. It was customary for the Romans to crucify people. That was one of the most cruel acts of capital punishment. So he decided to do that on our Lord. But after that, I don't know whether they continued, but the thing was, yeah, of course, there were many saints who were crucified, including women. There were many women who were martyred by crucifixion. So, but the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ goes with him everywhere. The difference between our cross and that of the other Christians is that their cross have no Christ, but our own cross have Christ. They don't have Christ on their cross, but our own cross, because the cross has to do with Christ. Actually, today is a double feast celebration. It was on this day, 14th of September, that the cross on which our Lord was crucified was discovered by St. Helen, the mother of Constantine. But they said, he took some men and went to Calvary and told them to start searching. They continued digging everywhere until eventually they came across a pit that had three crosses. So because the whole story was that after the crucifixion, when our Lord's body had been taken down, and those of the Jews were taken down, the Jews gave instruction to take those crosses and throw them into a pit so that the apostles would not have access to it. And everybody kind of forgot about it until 300 and something, the three crosses were touched on somebody who is sick. And then one of them cured him. So they recognized that it is the cross of our Lord. And so St. Helen built a church there on Calvary where the cross was placed. So, but after many centuries, there was a time I think he was the patient, one of the patient king called Kuros or whatever. He fought against the Christians in this thing, and then conquered them and took away the crucifix. He brought out and took the real cross and took it away. So when he took it away, the emperor, who was a Catholic emperor then, was so angry. So he decided that he's going to recover it. So he went to, it's a long story, but he went to war with just the chorus, whatever. And then when they were fighting, the second battle, he conquered them, and then the king, the very king who took away the cross, ran away. He crossed the river and ran away. And when he was running, he said that his second son should take over his kingdom until he comes back. So the first son felt angry and said, "This is an insult on him." So he plotted and killed the king and his brother and took over the kingdom. Then he wanted to make peace with the emperor. The Christian emperor, the president said, "The first condition is restore the cross." So he agreed, and then he restored the cross. So they took back the cross. And then when they brought it back, the king decided to take this cross to place it back at the church where it was. So he carried it all the way from wherever they were carrying it. And when they came to the gate of the gate to the church, he could no longer move forward or backward. Whatever he does, the cross keep pulling him back. He just couldn't cross. So he did everything. So when this story gets in, the bishop, I think the bishop of Jerusalem there or something like that, sent a message to the king and said, "Look, because he carried the cross with all his regalia, with his crown and all his clothes." So he said, "How can you carry a cross with all your crown and all your regalia? The cross that Christ carried almost naked with bleeding and everything. You need to go and put off all your things and then and try." So he went and took off all his regalia, all his clothes and this, and then put on a poor, simple man's clothes. Carried the cross, the gate opened. He took it there and placed it at the right place. So it was, I said, it is on the 7th day of September 14th that these two things happened. So that's why we are not what we are celebrating today. But then our Lord and Savior made it a day for the exaltation of the cross with a devotion to the precious blood. So I want to talk a little bit about what our Lord has said about the rejected crosses. We didn't know the significance, or if you want to know the significance of the cross in a Christian life, everything we do in the church starts with the sign of the cross. When the priest blesses us, bless you with the sign of the cross. When you have been baptized, the first thing the priest will do, place the sign of the cross on your forehead and on your heart. When you be anointed with the oil, to be done with the sign of the cross. When the bishop is blessing the hand of the priest with the sign of the cross. If the bishop is consecrating an altar with the sign of the cross. Whatever we do in the and you should do the sign of the cross as many times as possible in the day. This is a way to remind us that it is through the cross that we can get to heaven. Remember the anguish of Peter, I think it's number 5, where our Lord said that some people have abandoned their crosses for him to carry. They abandoned their crosses and left feet for him to carry. He said, those who love him should help him to carry these rejected crosses. The rejected crosses have come, especially they multiplied since after the changes in the church. If I have to use Nigeria as an example, thousands, hundreds of thousands of Catholics have abandoned their faith in favor of the Pentecostals, where they go to look for miracles. All the world is miracle. The miracle Christ, not the Christ carrying the cross. Of course, yesterday, for those of us who were listening, our blessed mother said a lot about the Pentecostals yesterday, about their method of prayer. Our Lord also said it, that all they preach is prosperity and not the cross. And that is even against the very Bible they quote, because St. Paul says, woe to me if I preach nothing but the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. The cross is the key to heaven. Without it, you can't go in. You can't make it. Our Lord said it. He said, the only road, the only way that leads to the promised land is the way of the royal cross. The narrow way, the mingling way, the potter-potter way, the slippery way, that's the way that leads to the kingdom. If you don't follow it, forget it. And you may have, you may even, if you are following the way, you may fall several times. That will be for your good. When you fall, you rise again. But those who prefer the smooth road, our Lord said it is a smooth road that goes to hell. No bumps, no signs, just highway. You get in. The only way you get to the edge, you descend down into the deep valley of the ocean of hell. But the way to heaven is just deeply, you know, rugged, stony. So many of these things, you will come, you turn this way, sometimes you find yourself going back, and then you find yourself going east, west, north, south, and then eventually when you come to the gate, when the gate opens, then you see the beloved kingdom. But then your body must have been full of bruises. Because the idea is, you know, like some of our other Christians, they say, oh, Christ has suffered for us. He has paid the price for our salvation. We don't need to suffer. We don't need to do any penance anymore. Just when you die, you go to heaven. Of course, when you go to heaven, our Lord will show you. That's the reason he left the marks on his hands and his feet. He will show you with the mark of the wound and ask you, where is your own mark? You don't have any, no bruises, nothing. Okay. You have to go and get some. So this is a secret, and our enemies knew that. That is why after they have tried for several centuries killing Christians, it didn't work. They decided to grant the church freedom to worship. You know, we worship for many centuries, you know, without persecution, and then this thing. The church was only battling for heresies, and then after heresies, we have the schisms. After the schisms, we have the Protestantism. And the Protestantism, the Pentecostalism, and all these isms of the negative way. So, but all these things have taken away the crosses from us. That was a day I preached. I talked to the people in our church about saying thank you. Here in America, thank you is like everywhere. Thank you everywhere. you buy something in the store, thank you. If you get the receipt, thank you. If you get a flight, thank you. If you open the door for somebody, thank you, everywhere. But people don't do thank you in their homes. And Americans don't say the grace after meal. They don't thank God after they eat. That's one thing I've observed. Even if they go in a gathering where people will just, you know, if the priest is there, say, Father, bless the food for us, the Father will bless food for them, and everything. But after eating, everybody will do his prayers, so we will go to go talking and chatting, no thank you to God. I said, why do you do that? Many husbands don't say thank you to their wives. Many wives don't say thank you to their husband. They never do that. Instead of doing that, they can quarrel and fight and argue, but no thank you. And because of that, children don't say thank you to their parents. In our culture, you are groomed to say thank you after eating. You thank your mom and thank your dad, and even your senior siblings. But here, there's no way. So why I mentioned is that we don't show appreciation for what our Savior and our Lord have done for us. And when he offers us those little things, because he said in the Abir, I think Sister Abir says, he said, where is the Veronica of the last day? Where is the woman who could console me? All he asked us, say sorry, console me. We are not ready to do that. When I was in Los Angeles, if I'm not saying mass, I'm in the rectory, and then the phone will ring. And I pick it up. Somebody asked, can I speak to someone? I say yes. Said, Father, what the time for the next mass? I would tell them, okay, like, this is the 7 o'clock mass now, the next mass will be 11 o'clock. And she said, how long will it last? I said, okay, how long will you want to stay in heaven? And they would drop the phone. How long will the mass last? They are coming to mass here in the hall. You want to jump into your car and drive. Some people drive the whole day on Sunday. Go camping, go swimming, go fishing, go everything. They spend hours. Some spend hours watching the television report. When you come to mass, they want to go very, very fast. Okay? Well, so these are the little things, the little crosses we reject. Little crosses. Not the big ones. When someone gets sick, they get sick and they will remember to pray and pray and pray. And after God has cured them, no thank you. Yeah, you've done your work, okay, yeah, you did a good job, that's it. Period. How can we treat him that way? So the feast, this particular feast is meant to remind us that every cross, I think Blessed Mother mentioned it in one of the messages, I think it was yesterday, I think 4 years ago. He said the rose flower is the most beautiful flower on earth. But hold it, if you hold it strong, your hands will be bleeding because the thorns will pierce. That's strong. That's why I remember one people whom I married in the church somewhere in the parish where I was a long time ago now. So when the young lady who was waiting came to the altar with this beautiful rose flower, so when they came to the altar, I took a cross and put on it. So remember, marriage is also, so not only flower, not only flower, sometimes the cross here for that. Yes, because by the time you live 10 years in the marriage, then to me. So because marriage is not flowers only. But you can make it flower if you want. So these are the things, when we talk about the cross, it is in everything we do. When we talk about, yesterday we were talking about modesty. Modesty can be a cross. You may decide, okay, because the Lord wants it, I'll give up my whatever beauty I have, whatever, and then try to dress in a way that will be pleasing to my Lord. Read the life of the saints. I don't know whether some of you have read the life of St. Rose of Lima. St. Rose Lima lived her life. She didn't refuse to marry. And by the way, her real name is not Rose. I think her name is, I've forgotten the real name. But it was because of her beauty, people started calling her Rose. They said her cheek is so beautiful, looks like a rose. So when people from the time she was born, people started calling her Rosa, Rosa, Rosa. So she took a third order Carmelite vow and refused to marry. But there was something that said that happened. One day somebody came to visit her and they were talking. The person looked at her fingers. Her fingers were just marvelous. I said, oh, Rosa, look at your fingers, so beautiful. She kept quiet. When the person left, she went and put her fingers on fire. And it blitzed her. That was it. Some of these saints, if you read their life, you'll be shocked what they did. That some who flogged themselves, in order to, because they want to. Because it's either there are two types of crosses, either the Lord may give you a cross and you accept it, or you take some on your own. Sometimes the Lord may give you a cross that is lighter than the one you give yourself. Like as it happened in this parable. He gave somebody a cross. He said, it's too heavy. He said, okay, go and take one from the rejected one. He went there. I found that all of them were heavier. And he came back with his own. So you can't make heaven without the cross. The cross can even be a bad marriage. You get married to a very, very horrible man. And he will be, what do you call it in America? Abusing you, and decide to stay in that marriage with that abuse, you are making your sainthood. But the normal thing is that, oh, you abuse me, you call the police and then go to court and then they chase the man away and take his children and the house and then pay you any money or whatever money. It's all about money. You rejected the cross, period. Could be a wife that is so stubborn, so I don't know whatever to how we do, and then he had to bear with her. Keep enduring. That may be your cross to heaven. Maybe a sick child, maybe a sick mother, your mother-in-law, your father-in-law. You have to stay with them. And because some people don't want any dog problem. Want no mother-in-law, no father-in-law, and maybe they have boys, they have their children among them, some of the boys, and when you have boys, you have to have father-in-law and mother-in-law, okay? But you don't want your own. These are the crosses. Convert your problem. And like our Lord said, I think there was one way he said, offer your difficulties, your whatever you have, offer them up to me in reparation for your sins and the sins of the whole world. Offer those things in reparation. Whatever you suffer, whatever you go through. So these are the rejected crosses that, you know, that our Lord is talking about. I think there was a story that from the beginning of the church, from wherever the color law started, until the year, I think, 1960-something, there were only three annulments in the church. One of them was that of King Henry VIII, who later adopted and then gave the church and then started the Church of England. Only three. But from that time till now, we have thousands. Because people are no longer ready to carry the cross of the marriage. Because your husband is abusive or abusive, whatever, you decide to go away, forgetting that the children you have got the children need the father and the mother to grow up, otherwise they grow up like animals. It's the only animals that have single parents. We forget that. When you start to be a single parent, you just have your own children and you raise your children without their father. Then there's something those children will never grow to be normal people. And it is you have rejected the cross. Maybe at the end of your life you will see what benefit you would have got if you had stayed in that marriage. So God has many, many ways to offer us things. Something could be a sick child or a sick husband or a sick wife. There was a story about one Audrey in New York. This child was born, he was stillborn or something like that, he wasn't moving. So the husband of the woman said, I don't think we can deal with this child, why not throw it away? The woman said, no, this is my child, I can't throw it away. And then she said, nothing, it's 1 year, 2 years, the child is just in bed, he doesn't eat, nothing. So one day the husband just abandoned them and packed out. This woman stayed with the child. It was when, and the child was growing in the bed until she was 15 years old. She started walking miracles. People would come there and they didn't look at her and they go and their sickness would be cured. That's what, I think it was the ABC that did the 30 minutes whatever program on that. It was when it became public, then the husband moved back. Because when there was God miracle after that, he came back. Go and investigate into that. So don't reject your cross. Because if you reject it, it still be waiting for you. As soon as you be there last, you will see this cross at the entrance to a poor gathering. Wherever you are, as soon as you get into the gate of God and you see your cross, they will say, okay, you feel this cross now. Take it and finish off the joint. You be important. Complete the whole thing. So because, you know, there's no short way to heaven. No short way. No abbreviation. It has to be that way. So that is why, you know, we don't know what we miss, because you are going to eternal kingdom. Heaven. See, heaven is, look at some Nigerians think that America, that some from Nigeria, if you tell them to sell everything they have and get a visa to America, they will do that. Sell everything they have. And then give them visa to America, because America is heaven. And then think about the real heaven. And you think you can go without dirty hands, without blood and things like that. No. So that is why when we talk about the mercy of God is purgatory. The mercy of God, because every sin we commit deserves death. Because God doesn't tolerate any least, that's why he gave us the Ten Commandments. If you violate any of them, you are done. Peter doesn't want anybody to come to heaven and challenge him again. Think about how many years this, some people say the earth has been like how many million years. That's how many, if the earth is 1 billion years old, then God is how many billion years old? He's an old man. He doesn't want you to come there and start causing trouble. Yeah. You can't do that. And St. Michael will not leave you alone. He just, with his wing, he will just take you, flip you. Yeah. So, you don't just want to do this. So that is it. And that's one thing that the people who change the thing, they just took away all those things that maybe just, you know, take it easy, you know, whatever you do, you go to heaven. You go to heaven. So, okay, go on. So you have to make some sacrifice. and a lot of feet. There was a story about, there was a time I did some studies on purgatory. I was terrified when I read something, some of the things that, about some of the things that happened in purgatory. If you read the life of St. Mary Magdalene the Pazzi, she was taken so many times on a journey to purgatory because she was had devotion to the souls in purgatory. Things that you may think that they are very, very minor than any serious things in purgatory. That was, they said there was one pope, two bishops, they were very, very friendly. And then one of them died. And the other one was saying mass for him every day, almost 6 months. After 6 months, one day he was in the chapel and this bishop appeared with his, with flames all over him. And the bishop asked him, "What is happening? Where are you?" He said, "I'm in purgatory." He said, "What about the masses I'm offering for you all this time and those of who many other faithful?" He said, "God just decided that when I was on earth, I didn't offer enough prayer for the souls in purgatory. So all this prayer that I be offered to me will be used to save those I should have saved. Then after that, it will be applied to me." One other pope had 360 years to stay in purgatory because of one serious decision, wrong decision he made. Countless. There was a parish I worked in Nigeria. One day when I came over here, one time I went back to visit somebody died. I went back to visit I went for the funeral. After that, one young man whom I know, actually his name is a barrister. So he had a sister whom I know. That a young woman, she may be in her 30s or 40s then, but she was a widow. Very, very good, very devout. She's in the Virgin of Mary. She don't, whatever work you do in the church, she's there. So they said she got sick, maybe could be cancer, whatever. And they tried everything, they couldn't care. So one day she was, eventually she died anyway. So after she died, after the funeral, the brother came to me and said, "Father, that he wants me to say a novena mass." I said, "How can you give me a novena mass on the road? Suppose I go away and someone spend the money and forget it." Father, if he tells me the story that I may consider, so what is the story? I was in my car. He called her his sister, whom I know. He said that since she died, she had appeared to three people. The same story that she told them that there was one day she was alone in her house and the bed, and she was in very, very severe pain. And she was wriggling on the bed, turning her face this way and this way. At the time, she looked around and saw the picture of her blessed mother that she kept at the corner of the house. And she just stood like this and was angry to it. I said, "Are you watching me here to die? If I die, who is going to raise these children?" She thought it was a joke. When she died, she said it was 80 years in purgatory for insulting the blessed mother. Insulting the picture of the blessed mother. Because that is a view. Yeah, because instead of praying, say, "Oh, please, mother, help me," things like that, because she was angry with that. Who are you to be angry with the mother of God? 80 years in purgatory for that. And she said, the only thing was, through the blessed mother, she was granted the permission to appear to people and ask for masses. So, the cross is either you carry it here or it's waiting for you over there. That is the mercy of God. Otherwise, the next thing is hell. So, those who are going to be consecrated, you know the conditions. You have to carry your cross. You have to be ready for temptations. You have to be ready to, according to the prayer, consecrate the precious blood, you have to be involved in propagating this devotion. Because when you get it, you say, "Okay, I'm saved." You take it and go to your house and faith and joy. You have to share with others. You have to be involved. That's the idea of being consecrated. It's like being an active member in the Legion of Merit. You can be an auxiliary member, but if you're an active member, you have to be go to Legion of Merit, try to get people to the kingdom. So when once you are consecrated, you have to be involved. Get other people. No, get them involved. Try to console our Lord. Try to console. That's all he needs. Just console him. Console him. He said, for women, your duty is to wipe his agonizing face. For the men, they can help, can carry the cross physically and do other things. But there's something you can do that you have to do also. But then be ready for temptation. The devil, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.